वेलकम टू द थर्ड एपिसोड ऑफ संडे संवाद. आई एम डिलाइटेड टू बी बैक विद यू एंड आई एम सिंपली ओवरवेलम्ड विद योर कंटिन्यूड रिस्पॉन्स, मोर सो फ्रॉम यंगस्टर्स हु स्पेयर देयर टाइम टू पार्टिसिपेट इन दिस डायलॉग. एंड आई फील हैप्पी दैट दे आर सो अलाइव टू इम्पॉर्टेंट सोशियो इकोनॉमिक इशूज इन द कंट्री. Many of them have expressed to me saying that they want to be an integral part of India's growth story. They believe in this government and its policies, in our Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi, and in the principles that we stand and fight for. For all my young friends, I quote some lines that I just read on the CRPF site. लड़खड़ा संभल के देख, बड़ा कदम तू चल के देख, मोम कर दे मुश्किलों को सूर्य सा निकल के देख. डिस्पाइट द पेंडेमिक क्राइसिस दैट द वर्ल्ड इज फेसिंग, आवर डिफेंस एंड पैरामिलिट्री फोर्सेज फेसिंग ऑल ऑड्स कंटिन्यू टू गार्ड अवर बॉर्डर्स. आई टेक दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी to pay my humble tributes to them. Now, back to Sunday Samvad. I have about a backlog of 1,000+ questions from all of you, out of which I have chosen about 30. Now on to question number one. The very first question in this Sunday Samvad I have is from Mohak Sharma ji, who belongs to Patna, Bihar, and is an avid Chelsea football club supporter. He has asked, "Sir, according to the World Health Organization, in India, there is just one government doctor for every 10,189 people, while the WHO recommends a ratio of 1:1,000. Are there any plans to improve this ratio now or after the pandemic?" Mohak ji, on September 30, 2019, 12 lakh allopathic doctors were registered in India. Assuming 80% availability of these doctors, 9,61,000 may be available for service, giving us a doctor population ratio of 1:1,404 against WHO's prescribed ratio of 1:1,000. In addition, there are Ayush doctors as well, which would improve this ratio even further. Moreover, this ratio of doctor population varies across states and rural-urban regions across India, public health and hospitals being a state subject. The primary responsibility to ensure the availability of doctors in public health facilities lies with state and the union territories. However, the central government has taken several steps to increase the number of medical seats in the country. 29,185 MBBS seats have been added during the last 5 years. We are establishing new medical colleges, strengthening and upgrading existing government medical colleges, relaxing the norms for setting up of new medical colleges, enhancing the maximum intake capacity at MBBS level from 150 to 250, and also enhancing the age limit for appointment and extension of teachers, deans, principals, and directors of medical colleges. All these steps will definitely help to improve the doctor ratio in the country. Going over to question number two. The next question is by Amit Verma ji from Chandni Chowk, Delhi. This is my own constituency. He has asked, "Sir, Disinfection tunnels are still being used widely in temples and offices. These have a negative effect on the body. Why haven't these been banned yet? Amit ji, I would like to inform you that on April 18, 2020, my ministry, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, issued an advisory against the spraying of disinfectants on people, saying that under no circumstance should it be done, as it is physically and psychologically harmful. The advisory also clearly states that there is no scientific evidence that suggests that spraying disinfectant on people has any significant role in containing the COVID-19 outbreak. On the contrary, it can lead to adverse effects like irritation of eyes, skin, nausea, and vomiting. Based on this advisory, many state governments, district and civic authorities have already banned the use of such disinfectant tunnels and chambers. Question number 3 is from Jasnoor Kaur from Chandigarh, who is an IT engineer and wants to pursue law in the future. She asks, hundreds of cases of COVID-19 infection are occurring these days due to prolonged hospitalization. Hospitals in India have poor infection control practices. Sir, please visit any Delhi hospital right now and you will see what proportion of the guidelines are being followed. There are no checks in place and it looks like there is no system to impose stiff penalties on hospitals. What are we doing to improve this scenario? Being a doctor, it seems you have a softer corner for hospitals and the administration and not for the patients. Jasnoor ji, the government is aware of the importance of infection prevention and control, or IPC practices. India has given due cognizance to the problem of antimicrobial resistance, and to tackle this issue, a national program on containment of antimicrobial resistance is being implemented. One of the essential pillars of this program is IPC practices. We had issued the guidelines on IPC in healthcare facilities in January 2020 itself. COVID-19 pandemic has now presented us with an opportunity to strengthen these infection prevention and control practices even further. We issued guidelines on the rational use of personal protective equipment for healthcare workers and other staff working in both COVID as well as non-COVID areas of the hospitals. Capacity building modules on IPC in the context of COVID have also been made available online at iGOT platforms. However, I would like to add that health is a state subject and the primary responsibility of implementing IPC falls on the concerned state and the union territory governments. Agla question Ankita ji ka hai, wo poochti hai, jab 200 case the tab sab band tha, ab roj ke 1 lakh case hain to sab khul raha hai, ye kahan ka logic hai doctor sahab? Dekhiye Ankita ji, aaj jab har taraf corona ka khauf hai तो इस तरह के सवाल आम आदमी के दिमाग में आना स्वाभाविक है। देखिए, सबसे पहले तो आपको यह समझना होगा कि लॉकडाउन क्यों किया गया था। शुरू में इस बीमारी को लेकर दुनिया के पास बहुत कम जानकारी थी। भारत भी शुरुआती दिनों में इस बीमारी से निपटने के लिए उतना तैयार नहीं था जितना अब है। निश्चित तौर पर जब लॉकडाउन किया गया था तो केस बहुत कम थे, लेकिन हमें इससे निपटने के लिए कुछ तैयारियां भी करनी थी जो हमने की। लॉकडाउन का एक उद्देश्य यह भी था कि कोरोना के संक्रमण को रोकने के साथ उससे निपटने के लिए तैयारी कर ली जाए। लॉकडाउन के कारण कोरोना के संक्रमण को रोकने में काफ़ी मदद मिली और हम इसे काबू करने में भी सफल रहे। आज अगर धीरे धीरे सब कुछ खोला जा रहा है तो इसलिए कि हम कोरोना से निपटने की स्थिति में हैं। शुरू में डॉक्टरों को कोरोना वायरस के बारे में बहुत कुछ मालूम नहीं था, लेकिन अब उन्हें इससे निपटने के तौर तरीके मालूम चल गए हैं। आज इस बीमारी से निपटने के लिए जो भी ज़रूरी संसाधन चाहिए वो हमारे पास हैं, चाहे वो टेस्टिंग की सुविधा हो या फिर वेंटिलेटर या बेड की। हमें मालूम है कि हम किसी भी विषम स्थिति से निपट सकते हैं। उदाहरण के तौर पर पहले हमारे पास कोविड टेस्ट के लिए केवल एक लैब था, लेकिन आपको यह जानकर खुशी होगी कि आज हमारे पास 1823 से अधिक लैब्स हैं। इनमें हर रोज़ 10 से 15 लाख के बीच टेस्ट हो रहे हैं। अगर आप पिछले 2 दिनों की बात करें तो देश में 13 से 15 लाख टेस्ट हुए हैं हर रोज़। पहले हम मास्क, पीपीई, वेंटिलेटर्स, टेस्टिंग किट्स आदि के लिए विदेशों पर निर्भर थे, लेकिन कोविड के खिलाफ लड़ाई को मजबूती देने के लिए हमने लॉकडाउन के दौरान देश में इनके उत्पादन को बढ़ावा दिया ताकि हम दूसरे देशों पर निर्भर ना रहें। आज स्थिति यह है कि हम ये सामान विदेशों को एक्सपोर्ट कर रहे हैं। नया वायरस होने के कारण कोविड-19 के बारे में लोगों को शुरू में यह पता नहीं था कि इसका ट्रीटमेंट कैसे होगा। जानकारी ना होने के कारण असमंजस के चलते दुनिया के विभिन्न देशों में कई जानें चली गईं, जबकि लॉकडाउन के चलते भारत में बहुत कम जानें गईं और मोर्टैलिटी रेट भी बहुत कम रहा। आज हमारा रिकवरी रेट लगभग 82% से भी अधिक पहुंच गया है और यह लगातार बढ़ रहा है। हालांकि कोविड का इलाज अभी पूरी तरह से खोजा नहीं जा सका है, लेकिन डॉक्टर्स को अब इस बीमारी के बारे में काफ़ी कुछ पता चल चुका है, जिसके कारण अपने देश में यह काफ़ी हद तक नियंत्रण में है। इसलिए धीरे धीरे सब कुछ खोला जा रहा है, लेकिन उसके साथ दिशा निर्देश भी दिए जा रहे हैं। अंकिता जी, आई होप आई हैव बीन एबल टू सेटिस्फाई यू विद माई आंसर। नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन आई हैव इज फ्रॉम वरुण जी फ्रॉम दिल्ली, हु इज एन एस्पायरिंग जर्नलिस्ट। गोइंग बाय हिज क्वेश्चन आई फील दैट ही इज डेफिनेटली ऑन द राइट कैरियर ट्रैक। वरुण्स क्वेश्चन रीड्स लाइक दिस। सर, आर यू अवेयर ऑफ ए हाई लेवल स्टडी दैट हैज प्रूव्ड दैट द लाइफ एक्सपेक्टेंसी ऑफ कोविड-19 पेशेंट्स who despite having recovered fully may reduce by 1 to 9 years and they may even suffer permanent damage to their heart muscles? Varun ji, we are well aware that there is recent emerging evidence that COVID-19 may not be just an acute disease of the respiratory system. The disease not only impacts our lungs but other organ systems also, especially cardiovascular and renal. As useful as these studies may be to draw our attention to these non-respiratory impacts of COVID-19, most of these studies are on a small scale involving a small sample of people. Therefore, any generalization of the results from these studies, especially in the context of our population, may be inaccurate. Anyway, the issue could always escalate and become more serious. Therefore, the Ministry of Health has already set up committees of experts to look into these facets of COVID-19. We have urged our institutions like ICMR to research actively on these issues. Hanish चौकसी ने सवाल किया है, सर अब सैलून खुल गए हैं और वहाँ लोगों से पीपीई किट के नाम पर अलग से पैसे वसूले जा रहे हैं, लोग पैसे देने को राजी भी हैं, लेकिन सवाल उठता है कि आखिर ये पीपीई किट कितने कारगर हैं? क्या आपके मंत्रालय ने इसके लिए कुछ दिशा निर्देश जारी किए हैं? लोग आखिर खुद को सैलून में कैसे सुरक्षित महसूस करें? देखिए, सैलून भले ही अपनी ओर से कोरोना संक्रमण से बचने के लिए एहतियात बरत रहे हैं, लेकिन आपकी जिम्मेदारी यहाँ ख़त्म नहीं होती। आपको सैलून जाने से पहले और बाद में बहुत सी बातों का विशेष ध्यान देना होगा, ताकि आपके साथ आपका परिवार भी कोरोना से सुरक्षित रह सके। स्वास्थ्य मंत्रालय ने कोरोना संक्रमण को रोकने के लिए कार्यस्थलों के लिए भी जो दिशा निर्देश जारी किए हैं, वो सैलून पर भी लागू होते हैं। सैलून जाने से पहले आप ग्लव्स, मास्क और शू कवर्स जरूर पहन लें। आपके साथ हैंड सैनिटाइज़र ज़रूर होना चाहिए। सैलून में डिस्पोजेबल गाउन का यूज़ करें या घर से खुद गाउन लेकर जाएं। आपको पीपीई किट की कोई ज़रूरत नहीं है, जैसा कि आपने लिखा है। सैलून के टावल आदि को यूज़ ना करें, डिस्पोजेबल टिश्यू का यूज़ करें। यदि चेहरे पर कोई सर्विस नहीं ली जा रही है तो मास्क के साथ चश्मा भी पहने। सैलून से वापस आने से पहले भी पूरी सावधानी बरतें। घर के बाहर ही अपना शूज़ कवर निकाल दें, इसके बाद अपने शूज़ अंदर लाएं। घर में आकर आप सबसे पहले बाथरूम में जाएं, घर के अन्य कमरों में जाने से बचें। अगर आप इन उपायों को अपनाएंगे, तो निश्चित तौर पर आप और आपके परिवार के लोग सैलून में सुरक्षित महसूस करेंगे। अगला सवाल अमित खन्ना जी की तरफ से है। अमित जी पूछते हैं, माननीय मंत्री जी, हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस कंपनियों ने कोरोना काल में लोगों को कोई राहत नहीं दी। जो लोग प्रीमियम नहीं दे पाए, उनकी पॉलिसी सस्पेंड कर दी गई या ख़त्म कर दी गई, जबकि इस समय इसकी ज़रूरत सबसे अधिक थी। आखिर सरकार ने इस दिशा में क्यों नहीं सोचा? लोग कहाँ से हेल्थ बीमे का प्रीमियम देंगे जब नौकरी ही छूट गई हो? इंश्योरेंस रेगुलेटरी एंड डेवलपमेंट अथॉरिटी ऑफ इंडिया ने हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस पॉलिसीज के प्रीमियम के भुगतान में छूट दी है। साथ ही सभी बीमा कंपनियों को यह भी निर्देश दिया गया है कि हेल्थ इंश्योरेंस क्लेम्स, विशेषकर कोविड से जुड़े क्लेम्स का निपटारा तेजी से किया जाए। इसके अलावा भारत सरकार की महत्वाकांक्षी योजना प्रधानमंत्री जन आरोग्य योजना के तहत भी बड़ी संख्या में लोगों को टेस्टिंग और इलाज की सुविधा का लाभ मिल रहा है। इस योजना के तहत भारत सरकार प्रति परिवार सालाना 5 लाख तक के मुफ्त इलाज की सुविधा देश के 10 करोड़ से अधिक परिवारों को उपलब्ध करा रही है। नाउ ए क्वेश्चन बाय अखिलेश शर्मा जी, हु इज पॉलिटिकल एडिटर एंड एंकर एट NDTV इंडिया। नाइस टू हियर फ्रॉम यू अखिलेश जी इन संडे संवाद। अखिलेश जी says, we have various reports claiming cases of reinfection of COVID-19 in India. Is there a possibility of reinfection in patients who have recovered completely? If yes, how serious is this issue? Akhilesh ji, there are some cases of COVID-19 reinfection being reported from across the world, not just from India. At the moment, the subject is still under investigation and doesn't appear to be a serious issue. However, in the Ministry of Health, each and every aspect of COVID-19 that is emerging is being actively studied and researched. You can be sure that these reports of reinfection are also being sufficiently examined. Expert panels working under the ICMR umbrella are examining this issue. Although the number of reinfection cases are negligible at the moment, yet we are fully seized of the importance of the matter. Please be reassured. Preeti Singh from Faridabad has asked, in the financial year 2019-20, India imported over 42,000 crore worth of medical devices, of which China accounted for 11%, which is about 4,500 crores. What is the plan to reduce this number under the Atmanirbhar Bharat scheme? Preeti ji, excellent question. Thank you for asking this at a time when our government is working round the clock to build a self-reliant India, a new India. Let me tell you that the government of India has adopted a two-pronged strategy of incentivizing production and creation of common infrastructure for high-quality medicines and medical devices to make the country self-reliant, Atmanirbhar. We are also trying our level best to enable our domestic manufacturers to become as competitive as their peers in foreign countries. In other words, the government is ensuring that there is import substitution in this sector, as well as we are no longer dependent on imports. Under these newly launched schemes, the government has proposed the development of 3 bulk drug parks and 4 medical device parks across the country. I am sure that in times to come, we will not just be able to meet domestic requirements, but also be able to fulfill global demand for low-cost, quality medical devices. In the last few months, since the outbreak of the pandemic, our government has taken many steps in this regard, in the form of manufacturing of ventilators, PPEs, testing kits, and many other medical devices. You will be happy to know that we are making steady progress in this direction. On to question to Shreya ji, who has asked a very interesting question. Her question is, sir, what is the CT value set by the government of India for RT-PCR test to identify COVID-19 cases? Is it the same as in other countries? Shreya ji, RT-PCR is the gold standard test for detection of SARS-CoV-2, that is the novel coronavirus. The RT-PCR test presently being conducted is qualitative, since specialized standards are required for quantitative assays, which are currently unavailable for SARS-CoV-2. For those who are not familiar, the cycle threshold or CT value of an RT-PCR reaction is the number of cycles at which fluorescence of the PCR product is detectable over and above the background signal. Our labs are using a mixed basket of kits having different CT values, and comparability of CT values among other kits remains a challenge. CT values also vary with the site of specimens collected, technical competence of the person collecting and performing the test, calibration of equipment and pipettes, and analytical skills of the interpreters. Theoretically, the CT value is inversely proportional to the amount of genetic material in the sample, and lower CT values generally correlate with a high viral load. Since there are several limitations of CT value and reliable evidence doesn't exist to definitely prove a direct correlation between disease severity or infectiousness and CT values, we do not recommend relying on numerical CT values. Rishi Agarwal from Jaipur has asked, in India, every state has established a different pricing for conducting the COVID-19 test. In some cases, the difference is 50 to 100%. Just like the government capped COVID-19 testing fee at ₹4,500 right at the beginning of the pandemic, why can't the government do it again at, let's say, ₹1,500? Rishiji, please understand that at the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, there was a crisis of testing kits and reagents all across the world. The situation was same in India, as we were heavily reliant on imported products for molecular detection of viruses. As such, in mid-March, no reference rates for RT-PCR test for novel coronavirus were available in the country. Keeping in view the cost of imported kits and efforts involved in carrying out the test, ICMR suggested the upper limit be kept at ₹4,500. Now, supplies of testing kits have also stabilized, and we have also commenced domestic production of these kits. Due to varied options of testing materials and kits, including indigenous ones, the prices are becoming competitive and undergoing reduction. We are now manufacturing over 10 lakh testing kits a day through domestic companies. The Ministry of Health has already written to the states and union territories to engage private laboratories at a mutually agreeable rate to bring down the rates. Several states and union territories have already brought down the prices of testing at our request. I have spoken personally to several state health ministers and their senior officers to reduce prices of testing in their respective states. Darshan ji from Kolkata, who is a huge cricket fan, has tweeted, "Sir, there are two aims in Jammu and Kashmir, but only one aims for the whole of Northeast. Is there a political reason for this, or do you think one is sufficient for the entire Northeast region comprising 8 states of India?" Darshan ji, Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Yojana is a central sector scheme aimed at correcting the regional imbalances in healthcare. The scheme has two components: setting up of new AIIMS and upgradation of existing government medical colleges and institutions. Therefore, the government is upgrading the medical infrastructure in the entire country in a phased manner. As far as the Northeast is concerned, under Phase 1, 2 and 3 of the scheme, central government is establishing 157 new medical colleges attached with existing district and referral hospitals across various states and UTs in India. These include Dhubri, Nagaon, North Lakhimpur, Dipu and Kokrajhar districts in Assam, Chura Chandrapur in Manipur, West Garo Hills district in Meghalaya, Falcon district in Mizoram, as well as Kohima and Mon in Nagaland. 90% of the cost of establishment of these colleges shall be borne by the central government. Darshan ji, hope I have answered your question to your satisfaction. Let me tell you that we are committed to improving the infrastructure in the 8 states of the beautiful northeastern region. It will be taken up in phases. Praveen ji has asked, "Dear Mantri ji, people are scared of sending their children to school. If members of parliament with all the security and safety are not safe inside parliament and are getting infected, how can the government expect hundreds of children to be safe inside schools?" Praveen ji, you are right that the safety of our children is of utmost importance. The government of India is keeping this in mind all the time while bringing out new guidelines during the phased unlocking of the activities. Currently, we have allowed only partial resumption of activities in schools for students of class 9th to 12th on a voluntary basis, and that too for taking guidance from their teachers. At the same time, it is noted that online or distance learning shall continue to be permitted and shall be encouraged. The ministry has issued guidelines in this regard for schools. These guidelines must be followed in letter and spirit to avoid the spread of infection. You must believe that the government is fully cognizant of this fact pointed out by you. We do understand that there is a new normal due to the occurrence of the pandemic. The decision to allow partial resumption of guidance classes for students of class 9th to 12th has been done following heavy demand from parents saying that their children need guidance. Please understand that attendance in these classes is voluntary. The policy decision is to encourage online and distance learning. Question 14. Kamlesh Ji, who is from Delhi and is a proud mother of two, has asked a similar question on schools reopening. She says, "Sir, is it safe for schools to reopen at this time when infections are seeing an exponential rise? Could you give me your personal opinion? If your children were young, would you dare to take the risk of sending them to school? Then why are you not putting your foot down for our children?" Kamlesh Ji, I understand what you are going through. However, now is the time to learn to live with the new normal. We cannot live in fear for long. The loss of an academic year would be a significant loss for the students. Having said that, we have encouraged the schools to reopen in a phased manner. States are monitoring the situation carefully. Schools as well as colleges shall resume studies in an online manner. Again, I am repeating that schools have so far been opened only for classes 9th to 12th, and that too voluntarily for those who want the guidance of teachers. This too will be subject to the written consent of their guardians. Such visits and teacher-student interaction must be organized in a staggered manner. If you have any suggestions in this respect, please feel free to send them here and we can take those into consideration and examine them. Question 15. Pratap ji ne sawal kiya hai, "Maniye Mantri ji, kya aapko nahi lagta कि अगर मुंबई में लोकल ट्रेनों समेत रेल सेवाओं पर अगर पहले ही रोक लगा दी गई होती तो कोरोना वायरस के मरीजों की संख्या में इतनी वृद्धि नहीं होती?" देखिए प्रताप जी, मुंबई में लोकल ट्रेनों पर समय रहते ही रोक लगा दी गई थी। अगर आप देखें तो कोरोना संक्रमण फैलने से रोकने के लिए 22 मार्च को ही मुंबई में सबर्बन लोकल रेलवे नेटवर्क को सस्पेंड कर दिया गया था। उस समय तक मुंबई में कोरोना इतना नहीं फैला था। 22 मार्च को लोकल ट्रेनों को बंद करने से एक दिन पहले यानी 21 मार्च 2020 तक पूरे देश में कोरोना के 300 से भी कम मामले थे और मुंबई में तो सिर्फ 30 केस थे। और फिर हमने देखा कि कैसे 25 मार्च से प्रधानमंत्री श्री नरेंद्र मोदी जी ने लॉकडाउन की साहसिक घोषणा की, जिससे कोरोना के संक्रमण को रोकने में काफ़ी मदद मिली। ऐसे में यह कहना कि मुंबई में लोकल ट्रेनों के कारण कोरोना के मरीजों की संख्या में वृद्धि हुई उचित प्रतीत नहीं होता। क्वेश्चन 16। अनीता जी ने पूछा है कि सर, आपने संसद में कहा कि लॉकडाउन से 14 से 29 लाख तक कोविड मामलों में कमी आई। इसी तरह 37,000 से 78,000 लोगों को मौत से बचाया जा सका। इस निष्कर्ष का वैज्ञानिक आधार क्या है, स्पष्ट करें। देखिए अनीता जी, संसद में मैंने जो लॉकडाउन को लेकर आंकड़े दिए, विशेषकर 14 से 29 लाख तक कोविड मामलों में कमी के और 37,000 से 78,000 लोगों को मौत से बचाने के, तो वो कोई हवा में दिया गया बयान नहीं था। ये विश्लेषण मैथमेटिकल मॉडल्स के आधार पर विशेषज्ञों के 5 विभिन्न स्वतंत्र समूहों द्वारा तैयार किया गया था। इसमें मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ स्टैटिस्टिक्स एंड प्रोग्राम इम्प्लीमेंटेशन के एक्सपर्ट्स भी शामिल थे। हालांकि मैं आपको यह स्मरण कराना चाहूँगा कि लॉकडाउन का उपयोग हमने अपनी स्वास्थ्य सुविधाओं को बेहतर बनाने के लिए किया और उस दौरान हमने जो तैयारियां करी उसके कारण आज भी लोगों की जानें बच रही हैं। क्वेश्चन नंबर 17 इज बाय उत्कर्ष जी, हु वर्क्स एज ए स्ट्रैटेजी कंसल्टेंट इन मुंबई। ही सेज, सर डोंट यू थिंक देयर इज ए नीड टू इंक्रीज द स्पेंड इन हेल्थ केयर विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द टोटल GDP? व्हाट डू यू थिंक शुड बी द आइडियल नंबर फॉर ए मैसिव कंट्री लाइक इंडिया? For a country like ours, strengthening of the public health system is always going to be an ongoing process. We are committed to increasing public healthcare spending by the government as a percentage of GDP from the existing 1.15% to 2.5% by 2025. This will mean an actual increase of 345% over the current share in this short period of time. As envisaged under the National Health Policy 2017, government is committed to achieving universal health coverage for all at an affordable cost, and Ayushman Bharat is a right step in that direction. Even the 15th Finance Commission's high-level group on health has said that healthcare spending must be raised substantially in the next 5 years. In fact, for the first time, the Commission's final report would contain an entire chapter devoted to healthcare financing. The Commission has also recommended a steep increase in expenditure on healthcare in view of the present pandemic. Sonia ji has asked, Dear Sir, people have noticed that the traffic police is very proactive in slapping challans for passengers not wearing masks inside their vehicles. Whereas in local markets, there are hundreds of people roaming about without masks and without following social distancing. Are we expected to call the police every time we see such incidents in the market? Sonia ji, there is nothing wrong in reporting irresponsible behavior. After all, the carelessness of a section of people can undo the hard work and perseverance of the government that is working overtime to contain the disease. There are diligent people who are following the government guidelines and wearing masks as well as following all protocols. Despite this, the infection spreads because of that small section of people who move around carelessly without taking precautions. Why only the police for taking action? Since it affects the entire society and people are dying from this disease, I think we should all be proactive. Let me tell you that very often I stop my car and request people to wear a mask when they are not moving around on roads without wearing one. My advice to you is that you must also do the same. Karo bhai, aap sab bhi proactively is movement mein bhag lo. See, The pandemic can only be fought when the government and society work together in tandem. The police, however proactive they may be, cannot challan each and every individual who is not wearing a mask. Society has to come together to promote hand hygiene, respiratory hygiene, and environmental hygiene practices. We are in this together, and we have to fight the COVID-19 pandemic together. हम सबको सिर्फ ये याद रखना है कि दो गज की दूरी और थोड़ी समझदारी पड़ेगी कोरोना पे भारी. क्वेश्चन 19. नारायण जी फ्रॉम बेंगलोर हैज आस्क्ड, देयर इज सो मच डाइवर्सिटी इन इंडिया, लद्दाख टू तमिलनाडु एंड गुजरात टू असम. हाउ आर वी एंश्योरिंग दैट द वैक्सीन विल बी राइट फॉर एवरीवन? नारायण जी, देयर इज ए स्टैंडर्ड प्रोसेस ऑफ वैक्सीन डेवलपमेंट. द वेरियस फेजेस थ्रू विच ए वैक्सीन ट्रायल अंडरगोज ensures that it will elicit the requisite immune response in a majority of persons. In phase 3 of vaccine trials, the dose is given to thousands of volunteers with varied ethnic backgrounds to test the efficacy of the vaccine while ensuring its safety. India is also participating in many of these vaccine trials, and therefore we will ensure that each stage of vaccine development is diligently followed to give an effective and safe vaccine for everyone. Kashmir to Andamans and Nicobar and Gujarat to Arunachal Pradesh. Next question is by Shreya ji from Hyderabad. She asks, there have been umpteen reports in the press with photos about how Amritsar's Golden Temple administration is openly flouting government guidelines on COVID-19. People have been asked to remove their masks before entering the sanctum sanctorum. Same for many temples. Why is the government not serious? Why is there no action being taken? Shreya ji, first of all, let me tell you that this is more of a state implementation issue. The government of India had issued standard operating procedures on preventive measures to contain the spread of COVID-19 in religious places of worship on June 4th, 2020. The SOP guidelines call for mandatory use of face covers or masks. We must realize that our fight against COVID-19 is a collective battle that the government and citizens must fight in unison. People must realize their duties and act responsibly, even in places of faith and worship. I advise people to follow all precautions in any gathering whatsoever, inside any building, wherever it may be. To follow social distancing, to wear masks, to follow respiratory etiquettes, and not to go out of your home until it is absolutely necessary. There should be no exceptions made until we are successful in containing the virus. God doesn't say don't wear a mask inside the temple. Bhagwan ye thodi na kehta hai ki aap mandir mein mask nahi pehen sakte. The thumb rule is that you cannot go to any crowded place without a mask. I have been saying this in all my interviews for the last many months. Please wear a mask the moment you step out of home, and step out only if necessary. Question 21. Abhishek ji ne sawal pucha hai. जब भारत कुछ महीनों में कोविड की वैक्सीन बना सकता है तो बाकी बीमारियों की क्यों नहीं? टीबी जैसी बीमारियों से भी तो हर साल लाखों लोगों की मौत हो जाती है. अभिषेक जी, वैक्सीन डेवलपमेंट एक लंबे शोध प्रक्रिया का हिस्सा है। इसमें काफ़ी वक्त लगता है। वैक्सीन कुछ महीनों में तैयार नहीं होती, इसमें लंबी प्रक्रिया होती है और ये हर वायरस और हर बैक्टीरिया के लिए अपनी जटिल प्रक्रियाओं से गुजरती है। जैसे कि HIV के लिए आज तक कोई वैक्सीन का निर्माण नहीं किया जा सका, क्योंकि HIV का वायरस काफ़ी जल्दी अपने मूल स्वरूप में बदलाव ले आता है, जिसके कारण वैक्सीन विफल है। लेकिन भारत में कई वैक्सीन्स पर शोध कार्य चल रहा है और इनमें से कई वैक्सीन्स अलग अलग क्लिनिकल ट्रायल फेजेस में हैं और उम्मीद है कि जल्द इसके कुछ उत्साहजनक परिणाम हम सबके सामने आएंगे। क्वेश्चन 22। चिराग जी जो प्रोफेशन से इंटीरियर डिज़ाइनर हैं, उन्होंने पूछा है कि सर, क्या भारत में कोरोना वायरस की वैक्सीन लगवाना अनिवार्य होगा? चिराग जी, कोरोना वायरस की वैक्सीन से जुड़े हुए सभी पहलुओं पर विचार करने के लिए सरकार ने एक एक्सपर्ट कमेटी का गठन कर रखा है। कोरोना की वैक्सीन पहले किसे मिले, उसका डोजेज क्या हो, वो सबके लिए अनिवार्य हो या नहीं, ये सभी बेहद गंभीर मुद्दे हैं, इसलिए इन सभी बातों पर एक्सपर्ट्स की राय ज़रूरी है। उनकी राय सामने आने के बाद ही कोई निर्णय लिया जाएगा। क्वेश्चन 23। तेजस जी फ्रॉम लुधियाना पंजाब हैज आस्क्ड मी, देयर आर मेनी आयुर्वेदिक एंड होम्योपैथिक मेडिसिंस अवेलेबल अक्रॉस इंडिया, व्हाई आर दे नॉट बीइंग यूज्ड टू देयर फुल पोटेंशियल इन द बैटल अगेंस्ट COVID-19? तेजस जी, मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ आयुष हैज़ प्रोवाइडेड सेल्फ केयर गाइडलाइंस फॉर प्रिवेंटिव हेल्थ मेजर्स एंड बूस्टिंग इम्यूनिटी विद स्पेशल रेफरेंस टू रेस्पिरेटरी हेल्थ। द ऑनरेबल प्राइम मिनिस्टर हैज़ टाइम एंड अगेन अपील्ड टू द पीपल टू फॉलो आयुर्वेदा फॉर इम्यूनिटी बूस्टिंग एंड सेल्फ केयर ड्यूरिंग कोविड पेंडेमिक। द आयुष मिनिस्ट्री एंड द काउंसिल ऑफ साइंटिफिक एंड इंडस्ट्रियल रिसर्च CSIR आर वर्किंग टूगेदर ऑन वैलिडेटिंग आयुष फॉर्मुलेशंस विच मे हेल्प टू बीट नोवल कोरोना वायरस। सिमिलरली ICMR एंड द मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ आयुष हैव डेवलप्ड रिसर्च प्रोटोकॉल्स for validating the claims of various Ayush practitioners who claim to have put together COVID-19 solutions. A call for proposals was made and shortlisted proposals are being examined. Similarly, ancient references often highlight the potential of Indian traditional medicines. Also, the Central Drugs Standard Control Organization has permitted Ayush practitioners to research COVID-19 for better understanding as a part of serious efforts towards the development of drugs based on Ayush systems. Also, recently, to encourage research in Ayurveda, the bill, the Institute of Teaching and Research in Ayurveda Bill 2020 was passed in Rajya Sabha to accord the status of an institution of national importance to a Jamnagar-based cluster of Ayurveda institutes. Question 24. Pratap ji ne sawal kiya hai ki sir, agar remdesivir aur plasma सिर्फ इन्वेस्टिगेशनल थेरेपीज हैं तो फिर इन्हें इतने बड़े पैमाने पर क्यों इस्तेमाल किया जा रहा है? अधिकतर हॉस्पिटल कोविड मरीजों के लिए इसका इस्तेमाल कर रहे हैं। प्रताप जी, सरकार इस मुद्दे को लेकर बड़े प्राइवेट अस्पतालों के साथ बैठक कर चुकी है, इसमें एम्स के डायरेक्टर भी मौजूद रहे हैं। बैठक में प्राइवेट अस्पतालों को साफ निर्देश दिया जा चुका है कि वे नियमित उपचार के रूप में इनका उपयोग ना करें। इस संबंध में राज्य सरकारों व केंद्र शासित प्रदेशों को भी समय समय पर निर्देश दिए गए हैं। एम्स दिल्ली द्वारा आयोजित क्लिनिकल सेंटर ऑफ एक्सीलेंस वेबिनार्स के दौरान भी राज्यों व केंद्र शासित प्रदेशों को विशेष रूप से बताया गया है कि वे रेमडेसिविर और प्लाज्मा थेरेपी का उपयोग नियमित रूप से करने से बचें। नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इन दिस संडे संवाद आई हैव इज फ्रॉम ए कोविड वॉरियर आदित्य फ्रॉम न्यू दिल्ली। आदित्य इज ए डॉक्टर बाय प्रोफेशन। ही सेज, सर बायोकॉन्स ड्रग आइटोलिजुमाब वॉज ग्रांटेड अप्रूवल फॉर COVID-19 यूज बाय द ड्रग रेगुलेटरी अथॉरिटी 2 months ago. Now, new research and the company's own admissions are raising doubts about the quality of the clinical trial that Biocon conducted. Why and how does Biocon exercise so much influence with the government that it managed to get through the clinical trials and approval for itolizumab? At least in healthcare, we should not have such scams. It will cost people's lives and responsibility lies with the government because they approve these sham drugs. Aditya ji, the drug itolizumab was granted restricted emergency use authorization by the Central Drugs Standard Control Organization. The important thing to note here is that it was restricted emergency use authorization. The inclusion of this drug in clinical management protocol for treating COVID-19 cases was examined by a panel of experts as well as in the joint monitoring group under the Directorate General of Health Services in the month of July 2020. It was recommended that current evidence is not strong enough to warrant the drug's inclusion in the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare's clinical management protocol for COVID-19. As I have stated several times in the interviews and previous editions of Sunday Samvad, COVID-19 is a new disease and therapeutics for COVID-19 are evolving. And the pursuit for an effective pharmacological agent would continue based on recent findings and researches. Question 26. Payal Sharma ji from Bhopal asks, sir, can you please share what exactly have we done to improve climate change research in India? Almost all of the studies that are available on the internet are written by foreign researchers. Payal ji, this is not true. In India, there is plenty of research that has been done on climate change. Our scientists at the Ministry of Earth Sciences, DST, and universities in India are involved in climate change research. The Center for Climate Change Research, Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology, Pune, is a center of excellence for climate change research. For the first time, the CCCER has developed an indigenous Earth system model for studying the past and future climate change over India. These model results will be submitted to the next Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC, Climate Change Assessment Report scheduled in 2022. This is the first time the results from an Indian model will form a part of the next climate change assessment report published by IPCC. And now on to Harkishan Suri ji, who has asked about our premier weather forecasting agency, IMD, Indian Meteorological Department. One of the key mandates of IMD is to promote research in meteorology and allied disciplines. Can you please share a few recent initiatives? Harkishan ji, the Indian Meteorological Department has the primary mandate of generating weather and climate forecasts and warnings for different users. Other than this, IMD also promotes research in meteorology to improve its weather services. In addition to their in-house research, IMD is involved in various major research programs. The most important program of IMD is its National Monsoon Mission. Today, we have the best forecasts in the world, and these are finding wide applications in the field of agriculture and improving productivity. IMD is now calling for research proposals from universities and other institutes on prediction of thunderstorms and lightning, use of weather radars for forecasts, and use of artificial intelligence and machine learning for different weather forecasting applications. Question 28. This question is posed to me by Varun Bhanot from Rajouri Garden, Delhi. He asks, everyone uses foreign weather apps on their mobile phones. Is there any Indian weather app that you can recommend? Any Indian API that we engineers can use to build an All India app? Hello, Varun. The Ministry of Earth Sciences has recently launched a couple of mobile apps for different applications. One such app is called Mausam, which is used for weather information and general forecasts for the next 5 days. It can also provide radar pictures for more than 300 cities across India. Similarly, Meghdoot is an app being used for the dissemination of agro-meteorological advisories and warnings to farmers in the country. Damini is being used for thunderstorm and lightning alerts. And RiseQ gives information about earthquakes. Application Programming Interface, or APIs as they are called, are available with the IMD and can be shared with those who are interested in collaborating with IMD for proper dissemination of weather information through mobile apps. Do write to us if you are interested. This question is posed to me by Shekhar Singh from Saharanpur. He asks, recently there was news about how a week old bridge built at a whopping cost of 250 crores was completely wiped out due to floods. Why are we not using the information repository available with the Ministry of Earth Sciences to engage in more robust infrastructure in vulnerable areas? Shekhar ji, the climatological information for any area can be considered before construction of any structure. The information about any meteorological parameters can be utilized to build a robust structure which can withstand the natural hazards affecting that area. For flooding events, normally designed storms are prepared to assess the danger level or the threat that can be expected from heavy rains or floods. The India Meteorological Department provides required weather and climate information to the Bureau of Indian Standards for preparing building standards. Also, IMD provides weather and climate information to Building Material Technology and Promotion Council, that is under the Ministry of Urban Development, for the preparation of Vulnerability Atlas of India. As and when the planners and designers request weather data, IMD provides that as well. Next question I have is from Ramesh Kumarji from Haryana. He says, sir, because of the new farm bill, the government is ensuring that all farmers will end up committing suicide. Why is the government taking away MSP and the freedom of the farmers? रमेश जी, गिवन दैट जस्ट 6-8% ऑफ फार्मर्स अक्रॉस द कंट्री बेनिफिट फ्रॉम द गवर्नमेंट्स MSP ऑपरेशंस एंड द गवर्नमेंट हैज मेड इट क्लियर दीज आर नॉट गोइंग टू बी डिसबैंडेड, इट इज़ वेरी वेरी क्लियर दैट द सो कॉल्ड फार्मर एजिटेशन इज एक्चुअली driven by vested interests. Moreover, the new legislation has nothing to do with MSP. Instead, its objective is simply to grant farmers and traders the freedom of choice to sell and buy agricultural produce outside the premises of APMC mandis. Agriculture reforms in India were long overdue, because the current system is corruption prone and monopolistic. Once the new reforms take root, it will make a meaningful difference to the sector and the lives of farmers, not just in few states but across India. This will transform the sector. The last question of the Sunday Samvad is by Somnath from Bangalore. He asks, Sir, ICMR's Zero Survey report has created a sense of indifference in people's minds. People have developed a complacent attitude after the report that a vast majority of people have either already contracted the disease or shall in any case do so in the near future. What is being done to ensure that people don't fall into this trap and are not complacent when it comes to a super infectious disease like COVID-19. ICMR has done 2 zero surveys. The first zero survey done in May 2020 demonstrated that the nationwide zero prevalence of novel coronavirus infection was only 0.73%. A second zero survey was conducted recently by the ICMR. It was conducted with identical parameters as the first survey in 70 districts across 21 states using the same sample size. Even the second zero survey indications are that we are far from having achieved any kind of herd immunity. The results of this second survey shall be released in the public domain soon. Both zero survey numbers are far below the levels of herd immunity, which is generally said to be achieved only when 60-70% of the population has zero converted. Therefore, we can derive the conclusion that a significant proportion of the population in India is still susceptible to infection. Please note this point and also explain to others around you, because people don't seem to have understood the implications of the results of the zero survey. The surveys are clear that a large population is still susceptible to this infection. Therefore, there is no ground for complacency. If community-based interventions for containment of infection, such as the use of masks, hand hygiene, and social distancing interventions, are not implemented effectively, then we may witness very high infection transmission rates, in turn leading to huge morbidity and mortality in the absence of a vaccine. Additionally, healthcare facilities will also be overburdened due to sudden upsurge in the number of cases. Therefore, community-based interventions for prevention and control of COVID-19 are the only available options now, and any kind of complacency will lead to very serious outcomes. Along with the government, it is the moral responsibility of all partners and stakeholders to disseminate information through electronic, print, and social media regarding effective implementation of community-based interventions for prevention and control of COVID-19. Somnath ji, through you, I want to convey to the people of India that there is no room for complacency. Please follow the guidelines strictly. If all of us can do that, we will be successful in mitigating this deadly virus. With this, we have finished the third episode of Sunday Samvad. I must thank you once again for starting this wonderful two-way communication with me. These are extraordinary times which demand extraordinary diligence. I want each of you to become ambassadors of good conduct in pandemic times. Practice and preach correct etiquettes to prevent corona infection. Be aware of government guidelines. The government is here to serve you, but it also needs your full cooperation. With these words, I shall take leave of you for this week. Have a great week ahead and see you soon in the next episode of Sunday Samvad.